a young boy growing up, the movies that I enjoyed watching had to do with castles and walls around cities and knights in armor and horses, you know, running into battle. I remember my imagination was fueled by those things. And like King Arthur, you know, Robin Hood, movies like that. These were real classics. Well, do you know that when you read the Bible was written over a span of about 1,500 years. And when you think of castles and kings and kingdoms, that was during the time everywhere around you would be kings and castles. And so it was nothing new for the people of God when you talked about a king and a kingdom and castles. That was their life. Now I want you to go with me in your imagination and think of Philadelphia as a kingdom. Okay, let's just kind of like backtrack in our mind. We know that the Native Americans, you know, were here before us, but let's just pretend that this was, you know, the Middle East and hundreds of years ago. Philadelphia maybe looked something like this, where everybody was packed in, Lord of the Rings if you don't know. Everybody was packed into this city, which had these massive walls around it, and it looked so impressive. But on the inside of this kingdom, call it the Kingdom of Philly, inside there were all kinds of problems. I mean, people hated each other, people were stealing from each other, you had to keep locks on every single thing. The court system was corrupt, the police were corrupt, the judges, it was just oppressive. And one day, because there were no leaders, one day a prince, Prince Deville, he rose up and took control of the city, not because he cared, but because he just wanted power. So Prince Deville just brought even more havoc into the city. He killed people whenever he wanted, he kicked them out of the city, and he did this, worst of all, he got his friends from outside the city in their kingdoms to come in and to destroy the kingdom. So he had them all brought in, these massive armies of people, to go ahead and fight against this kingdom. But he didn't care. Even though he was prince, he really didn't care because he hated the people. But then, little did he know, there was a king that had arisen. His name was King Theo. And King Theo came into this city and he overthrew. I mean, it took a while, but he overthrew this evil Prince Deville and kicked him out of the city, and he restored peace and blessing into the city. And people were happy. People were cheering. People were like, wow, we've been set free from this evil prince. Thank you, King Theo, for what you've done. But King Theo knew something. He knew that the people would go right back to their old ways unless something changed. So here's what he did. He wrote up an agreement. And in this agreement, he showed the people how they were to live as subjects to the king. And as himself, as King Theo, as king, he also dedicated himself to be a just king and an honest king and to work for the betterment of the people. And then he brought them into this agreement that they would come together and be royal subjects. So what he did in essence was this. He created a royal covenant. Now, a covenant means a sacred promise. And he asked the people, he said, people, will you commit yourself to entering into this royal covenant? me. Now, the picture that I just painted before you was actually a picture of what God did with the nation of Israel. You recall the story, how that God heard the suffering of his people as they were slaves in Egypt. And how God, the Bible says, by a mighty hand, mighty arm, he delivered his people with signs and wonders. Plagues that came upon the Egyptians because Pharaoh's heart was hardened. And the people left in the glory of God, and they passed through the Red Sea, and they were in the wilderness. And the Bible tells us 3 months had passed, exactly 3 months to the day. And God brought his people to a very special place, a mountain. This was not just any place. This was God saying to his people that I want to use this special place to enter into a royal covenant with you. A special agreement. So he had the people, he instructed them through Moses. He had the people prepare themselves for 3 days. I mean, they were just thinking about it. They were praying about it. They were wondering about it. And they had to be right. They couldn't be living in any sin. They had to get sin, you know, forgiven and out of their life, because this was a special covenant, a special time. And on the third day, as Moses was allowed to go up to the mountain, the Bible tells us that on the mountaintop, fire came down. There was smoke like the smoke of a great furnace. And there were thunderings, lightning. The mountain quaked like it was in an earthquake. Trumpets sounded, which became louder and louder and louder, until God spoke. He spoke to all the people. And the Bible says that God spoke all these words. Would you read it with me? Ready? Together? I am the Lord your God. Okay, wait a minute. Okay, ready? 1, 2, 3. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. Can you say amen at the reading of God's word?
Amen.
And so, what God did was he brought the people to this special place, and the first order of business at this special meeting was God identifying himself. Now, the people knew about God. They knew he had, you know, he was great. But God starts the conversation, because God is the one who writes up the agreement. And what does God say at the very beginning? He says, I am the Lord your God. Now, when he says, the Lord your God, what he's saying is, I am that I am. God's saying, I'm not just like a local God that people make up. I'm not something that people put their trust in that comes and goes. But I'm the God who always was, who am, I am, and I will always be. I am the God, he's saying, of all creation. And I have made you to be my special treasure. Because I am your God. God had taken the Israelites in a very small group of people from the whole earth, and taken them and had plucked them out and said, I'm going to be your God because I want you to show the nations of the world what it's like for people to serve God. So he identifies himself. And not only that, but this God is not just a God who takes and who receives from us, but he's a God that first of all gives us everything we have. And so he reminds the people, I'm a God who loves you, and I give you grace. I give you mercy. I give you help. That's why he goes on to say that I, the Lord, your God, I am the same God who brought you out of Egypt. I was the one who brought you out of slavery. Think about it. This God that we serve is the very God who forgives us of our sins, who breaks the chains of slavery to our sinful nature, who breaks that and gives us the power to be able to live in victory. That's the God that we serve. And so God is saying that to the people. I want you to know who I am, and I want you to remember what I do for you. This great God, this King of the covenant. And so Moses, we know the story, don't we? Moses goes up on the mountain, meets with God. And God knows that his people are going to need to know how to live. They don't just get it from looking at the clouds. And so God gives Moses the Ten Commandments. Okay? The Ten Commandments. These commandments show God's people what God expects of them, what God wants from them. Four of the commandments have to do with living in right relationship with God. There's that vertical element. No other gods before me. No graven images. Don't make any graven images. The third one, let's see, would be there's honor God on the Sabbath day. And don't take the name of the Lord your God in vain. Okay. And then the next six commandments have to do with right relationships with each other. So God is saying, this is how I want you to live. Honor your father and your mother, right? The commandment, you shall not murder, right? Isn't that, that's number, how are we now? Number seven, is that number seven or six? This number, whatever. Right. Don't murder, don't commit adultery. You shall not lie, bear false witness. You should not steal. And then lastly, don't covet. Don't desire to take what is your neighbor's. So God is giving us what he wants for us to live for him in the Ten Commandments. Moses brings them down from the mountain. I want to focus briefly this morning on the first commandment. Number one. Numero uno. Okay, the big one. Let's say it together. You ready? You shall have no other gods before me. Now, there is a reason this is number one. God doesn't just like throw all ten of them in the big bag and just pull out one and say, well, I guess I'll pick this one. No. If we don't get number one, we don't get any of the others. If we don't understand what God is saying here, then we don't have a clue of what he wants for our life. So, what is God saying when he says to us, his people, no other gods before me? You see, God knows us, okay? You don't know, sometimes you don't think that God sees, but he reads us like an open book. He knows everything about us. What surprises me most is that he loves us even still. But God knows that we this tendency to replace him. So what I want to talk to you about is don't replace God. The first commandment, don't have any other gods before me. Now you say to yourself, well, I don't worship any other gods. And the same idea is idols. You might say, well, I don't have any idols in my life, as if we're thinking, okay, I haven't carved any kind of, you know, god out of wood, or I don't have any stone shrine that I bow before every morning. Can I let you know that a false god is anything in our life that replaces God? The idols of our heart don't have to be something that we make with our hands. The idols can be things that are on the inside that we set up that to us are more important than God himself. Now, as I got this message from God in the last couple of weeks, I've been really praying, saying, God, what is it that you want me to share with your people? And this is what I feel to share. I want to share with you what I perceive as the three biggest false gods in America right now. Okay, would you go with me on this little journey? Because the Lord wants the best for us. And false gods won't take us there. False gods will always disappoint us. When you put your trust in anything besides God, you'll end up disappointed. And so many Americans, most Americans, have been deceived by these false gods. I'll give you the first one. Do not replace God with the small letter God of prosperity. Now it's interesting. The gods that I'm going to talk about that we replace here in America are not evil in themselves. Prosperity is not evil in itself. Money is not evil in itself. But what we do in our sinful nature is we take good things and we twist them so that they become more important than God. And when we do that, that's when we're putting gods before the true God. Now, is there anything wrong with prosperity? There's nothing wrong with God prospering your life, of giving you the ability to be able to have money to buy food, money to be able to live, transportation, clothing. So we cannot just say, well, take out your wallet because, you know, that's an evil thing and throw all the money away from you. But what happens is that we start to think in our mind that money is the answer for everything, that my happiness in life is dependent upon money. And so the scriptures warn us. The Bible makes it very clear that the love of money is the root of all evil. And Jesus said this. Jesus said that you cannot make money and God, both of them, your master, because one of them will win out. Okay? And Jesus has a lot to say about money and about how we are to honor God with our wealth. In fact, I believe that when we get money that comes into our lives, that is a test for us of how we will manage and steward the blessing that God gives us. So rather than saying, well, prosperity and money are evil, we need to say, God, how do you want me to use what you have given, whether it's small or greater? Jesus gives us the promise and says that he who is faithful in that which is little will be faithful in that which is much. So the problem isn't so much money, it's our love of money. Timothy is told by Paul, says that people who seek to get rich pierce themselves through with many sorrows. If money is your God, then you set yourself up for a lot of sorrows that you bring into your life. Because you will hurt people, you will run over people, you will break relationships, you will even leave God behind if you make money your God. So don't do it. Be responsible. Be a good steward. We're being taught that lesson again and again on Saturdays in our financial seminar. I have been in the ministry since around when I was 21 years old. And I just out of curiosity, I kind of flipped back through the pages of notes that I kept and discovered that I have actually officiated about 100 funerals. Now you might say, well, that's very depressing, Pastor. You know, but you know, I really thank God for being able to have gone to so many funerals. Why? Because it's a constant reminder to me of how short life is and how we need to be prepared to meet God. And I say this humorously that I have even ridden in the hearse, you know, in the caskets in the back. And I have never, you know, ridden in a hearse hitched to a trailer behind it carrying the person's stuff. That's never happened. Because Job said it so clearly. Job said, you know, when we were born naked, and when we leave, we're going to leave naked. And so, no matter how much stuff you have, you leave it behind. And so, isn't it better for us to manage the stuff that we have and bless other people and hold our hands out, you know, rather than going through life, you know, like, I need more. Because that makes me feel like a man if I have more money. You know, it's like, you understand? Living life, realizing that it's God's. And so, don't allow your heart to be led astray by the God of prosperity. Because many people in America worship prosperity and money. That's all they live for. Can I share with you the second God? Oh, I thought about the second God a lot. Okay. I forgot to tell you about Baal worship. That was the problem back in Israel's day. That was their God of prosperity. But we'll skip over Baal. He's not really important at all. Don't replace God with the God of what?
Pleasure.
The God of pleasure. All right. Hold on to your seatbelts. Now, pleasure. If I have a choice, pain over here and pleasure over here, what am I going to choose? I'd be an idiot to say, oh, pain is good. I love pain. You know, have more suffering, God. That would make me wonderful. No. We don't naturally choose pain. We would rather have pleasure. Okay. Is there anything wrong with pleasure? In itself, no. But, again, we just get so twisted that we take something that God has created as good and then we make it some kind of, you know, thing that we just worship in our life. Americans are obsessed with pleasure. I mean, you can't even turn the TV on and you got a commercial about, window cleaner, and they have to sell the window cleaner to you by getting you, first of all, filled with sexual thoughts. How does that connect with washing the window? I don't know. But you see, in America, we take something pleasurable that God has created for the blessing and the procreation of the human race, and we twist it to become, it's all about you and your feelings. So do anything you want to and get it any way you want, because after all, it's your life. So you see, we can replace, and we have replaced in America, pleasure over God. Does it make us better people? That's a question I ask. When we have a nation that pursues sex instead of God, does that make us a better people? I'm surprised in America that with all the emphasis we have on sex, that they don't give the warnings of sexually transmitted diseases. It used to be really prominent in the news, all the STDs out there, but somehow they're just blanketed over as if they don't exist anymore. Talk to any doctor that works with people in this area, and they'll tell you. See, God has a design for us which is good. And he has a design that brings him glory as well as brings pleasure to us. But it's within the realm of marriage. Pleasure can be anything, not just sexuality. I mean, I enjoy eating. How about you? It's pleasurable. But if I live to eat instead of eat to live, then I have some problems. And you name it, entertainment is pleasurable, right? I mean, if you've worked a day all day long and you come home and you put something on the TV or perhaps on the internet or you watch some news, that's entertainment, that's pleasurable. But, you know, how many times do I hear parents talking to me, my son, my daughter, all they do hours every day is they're just on the internet and they're playing games. And so we have to realize that, wow, we can't take the things that are pleasurable and replace them from God. Because what happens is that our whole life gets skewed. We think that we're just in this world to bring, you know, good feelings to ourselves. Well, really, we're in this world to love God, to honor God, and to bless others, to serve others. When I stand before God, I'm not going to stand before him and say, God, I wish I had more pleasure in my life. I'm going to stand before God and say, God, I thank you for the opportunity you gave me to serve. So I want to serve. I want to be a blessing to others because we can find our pleasure in life in helping other people succeed. People who are just always by themselves seeking their own pleasure, they're not happy people because God made us for more. So don't replace anything from God. Now, we're taught one thing in the Financial Freedom Seminar, this financial university, is that as we grow as people, we're learning how, as adults, to postpone gratification. You know what that means. You might look forward to having a certain dessert that's really good. You name it. You know, strawberry ice cream, okay. And you're looking forward to that, but you wait until a certain time to have that. If you eat that morning and noon and evening, then you become sick of it, and it makes you sick. So part of growing in Jesus and growing as mature Christians is learning how to do pleasurable things in moderation, learning how to delay our, the satisfaction of that. Because if we don't, it starts to take over our life. Can I give you the third one? This is a God that we don't want to replace for God Almighty. Don't replace God with other people. Now, do you love people? I hope you say yes. Because that's what God wants us to do. I mean, there is no perfect person So as you get to know someone, you have to make a decision. Do I still want to get to know them even though I see all these issues that they have in their life? Well, I hope the answer is yes, because we have issues just like they have issues. And so loving each other is not looking for the perfect person. It's basically accepting people where they are, trying to be a blessing to them so they can go higher and go further with it. But there's a danger. That's why Jesus put it this way. Jesus said, if you love father and mother more than me, he said, you're not even worthy of me. There are many places in the world today that if you give your life to Christ, you basically will have to say goodbye to your family because they will reject you. They will think of you as no longer part of their family. But Jesus says, you have to do that. You cannot put your family ahead of God. Now, I love my family. But even the one that's closest to me, my wife, when we were first married, we told each other this. We said, even though we're going to love each other, you're not first place in my life. And she told that to me too. She says, you're not first place either. God is first place. Amen. And if we put God first place, then it's going to be okay. Because if you put somebody else first place, and that's your idol, then guess what happens? People change. If your children are your idol, then guess what? They grow up and they leave. Sometimes they just get older and they leave and they bring back more people. That happens too. But life changes, and people die. No matter how much you love people, family, they're still getting older, and they're going to die. And so why not put God as God and do what he says and love people, but not replace God with people? If you think another person is going to make you happy, then I just got a news flash for you right now. It will never happen. There's nobody on the planet that God has created that will fulfill your happiness. Mm. Only God himself. And marriages never make it when both people look at the other person as, you're the person that's going to make me happy. Mm. They both disappoint each other, they hurt each other, and they separate. So, we're not on this place in marriage or in life to just say, how can people make me happy because they're my gods? No, we're here to say, God, help me to love people. But do that with your love. Jesus Christ is the King of Kings. He came to this earth. He defeated the devil. He wrestled from the devil the keys of death. And Jesus, the Bible tells us that he was asked a question about the greatest commandments. And he took the Ten Commandments of Moses. Now hear me on this. He took the Ten Commandments and he didn't throw them aside, but he filled all of them. And he condensed these Ten Commandments to make it real simple for us. He condensed them into two. And these are the two commandments that he said. He said, you are to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And secondly, to love your neighbor as yourself. So, Jesus, the King of Kings, invites us, his people, into a new covenant, which is the same thing as the king would do of that agreement. Will we agree to follow Jesus and to say, Jesus, I am willing to love you, to obey you, and to love other people? That's the royal covenant that Jesus Christ invites us into. If he's going to be our king and we're going to be his people, we enter into that, that sacred promise. So I'd like to ask you today as we're wrapping up, if you have never entered into a promise with Jesus, then recognize this. He wants you to know that he'll forgive you all your sin. Wow. He wants you to know that he will be with you your rest of your life. Every single hour, his presence will be with you. He wants you to know that he will be the source of joy and pleasure in your life. And he wants you to know that he will be with you for eternity. That you will have eternal life. Now, folks, what in this world can beat that? Absolutely nothing. But we have to be willing to be in agreement. We have to also be willing to say, God, I will do my part by loving you and obeying what you want me to do. That's our part. That's what Jesus said. If you love me, obey my commandments. Amen?